is Christian Uhrig, who will talk about the green growth and types of Cremona transformations.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's really a pleasure to be here in Moscow. So we continue with the Cremona group. So we are slowly moving more towards a group theoretical direction. So let me start with some motivation. So the following definition, group G is called a group of birational transformation. Group of birational transformations, if there exists a projective variety, X over some field such that G can be embedded into group PRX. So why could this be an interesting definition? Or so as we know, like, groups are very general concepts, and kind of like most pathologies in groups, they appear in some groups. But then there are some big classes of nicely behaved groups. For example, we have linear groups. But then again, being a linear group is very restrictive. So this may be something in between. So this generalizes linear groups. So for example, we have that linear groups are groups of birational transformations. But then there are also famous groups that are not linear, that are still groups of birational transformations. So for example, mapping class groups of compact surfaces, or the groups of automorphisms of free groups, and so on. These groups are all groups of birational transformations. So one could hope, if one understands groups of like these groups better, then one could also say more things about them.
I didn't hear about that.
It doesn't need to be projected. We can just
This group is no structure, right? No structure.
Just a group. But okay, the thing is, in higher dimensions, not so many things are known about these groups. So we can still only say in dimension 2 that really makes sense, and that they're really nicely and well behaved. And this will be kind of what we will try to explain you this week. And one can prove things about dimension 2.
How do you put things like making a group somewhere?
It's really about these character varieties. So you look at all if you look at all representations from the free group to SLNZ, SLNC or SLN already field, and then you quotient out by inner automorphisms, and then you get a variety on which the automorphism groups operates. And here you do similar things with the fundamental group of the surface. So it's character varieties. So an important tool to study birational transformations, or it turned out in dimension 2 and to be an interesting tool, was a tool, I don't know if it's called in dimension bigger, or degrees. So if we have a group, often it's nice to look at some length functions on the group, and groups of birational transformations are deformed with some free length function. So, for example, if f is a Cremona transformation, then f is given by d plus 1 homogeneous polynomials of the same degree. And you also have to ask that they are that they don't have a non-constant form factor. And then the degree of f is just defined to be the degree of the fi.
That is not a very nice definition because it depends on these formulas. So actually what we do, what we see we do here, we take a pullback of a general hyperplane and we intersect it with a line and we count how often it intersects. So a better definition for degree is to H is a hyperplane, and a class of a hyperplane, then the degree of F is just the pullback of the total transform of H intersected with a line. And here we see this can be generalized, so there's no reason to restrict ourselves to projective space. So if X is any variety, projective variety, and H is an ample divisor plus on X, then we define the degree of F with respect to H to be the total transform of H intersected with H intersected itself.
Typically speaking, total transform is not modified, right?
So X, let's say, is then it's
a rational transform, not total
transform. Well, just we just take the.
Yes, for
okay, so we get. So we get some kind of length function. And then there were people in dynamics that study these kind of questions, and let's just say there's a fact. So there were in the 90s, it was mostly Beam and Siboney, so people from complex dynamics, and then recently it was by Chong and Bakdang for positive characteristics. That these numbers are kind of well behaved, or behaved the way we want. So if we have x, h, actually smooth projective variety x, and the ample divisor h on x are given, and if we have, we fix any operator norm on of the one cycle of x. So the f star is a map, a linear map here, so we can look at the operator norm. And basically what they say is that that the degree behaves more or less like this norm. So they say there exists a constant c. Such that 1 over c is smaller than the degree of f with respect to h, and this is smaller or equal to the norm of f, and this is smaller or equal to c times the degree of f with respect to h. So this also shows that it doesn't really matter which polarization we choose, because it's mostly the norm up to a constant. And then the other one is also that this is always submultiplicative. So there is also a constant, the degree with respect to h of f composed with g.
This is a little bit not surprised, of course. This is everything is constant here. Yeah.
For all f.
Sorry.
Thanks. It does depend on f, of course, yeah, more or less. And that also the degree of f composed with g is smaller than the constant times degree of f times the degree of g for all f and g in your x. So I mean, this is easy to see. In this case, of course, if we compose the polynomials with each other, like it's most the product of the degrees. But you can show that this is true for all devices and all two projected branches.
I think, but then even then.
Well, the case isn't it just one? I mean, CLH?
Well, in this case, yes, but I mean, in general, I didn't put any restriction on H, for example. You could just take twice the hyperplane or three times the hyperplane. You need a constant in general. Like what you could if you take twice the hyperplane, then you get your a four because you intersect it twice. If you take twice the hyperplane, you get twice the degree. In dimension two, for example. Some people divide by
in this case by H. Get twice the degree, and then your student takes one.
Is there one of
them? Ah, one or two, if you take half times that, yeah, that's okay.
Or you're just taking care of the case when I divide H, when I take a pre-divisor, or divide H or something.
Yes. Or then in general, like if you have a general variety, then you can constant. Yeah, exactly. This case. Okay, and this allows us to make two definitions. So like what we can ask, the natural question that people in dynamics like to ask is what happens when we iterate f, like what happens to the degree? We could just look kind of like which kind of sequences can we obtain, like how do these sequences behave. So we can find, for example, a definition an integer sequence. If we just look at the limit.
And why do you insist on H being ample?
On
H being ample?
You could. It's kind of like we want it to be positive. We want it like these numbers. So that's really a length function. Like otherwise, if you get a negative. You could even look at. Like for groups, we really would like to have this sub-additivity and it has some dynamic importance. Yeah, a priori, of course, you could look at Mm-hmm. If then you have some integer sequences in general. Then the second definition is if well X is projective. Then we define the dynamical degree of F is the number by lambda F. So it could be the limit as n goes to infinity of degree of F n, and we take the nth root. And by this result, we see that the dynamical degree exists, and it does not depend on the choice of the amplitude divisor. It's the dynamical degree. Yeah, exactly. After a constant, it's if you have two different amplitudes, the degrees just differ up to a multiplicative constant. And then if you take the nth root on the iteration, it's constant. Okay. So the question is, if you can ask the following questions, which are very open in general. It's of course like which sequences are these degree sequences? Like in other words, what can you say about these sequences? For example, like which kind of growth can these sequences have, and so on. And the other question, of course, is which numbers are dynamical degrees? And also, what do these numbers tell us about? In dimension higher, like 3 or bigger, there's not much known about these questions. In dimension 2, we know a lot, and that's what we will see today. Okay, so let me give a small motivation, kind of as why it could be interesting to study degree sequences. So the following was a theorem by Bonifant and Fornes. They proved it for birational transformations of P of projective spaces. And then I generalized it for all varieties over all fields. But actually now it's with the new proof, that it's actually not a theorem anymore, it's almost just an observation, which is that there are only countably many degree sequences. It's okay, we can't say much about the sequences in general, but we know that there are only countably many. So there is some hope that degree sequences are very, very special sequences. Or there's some hope that that have some special behavior. And here really like to see, okay, of course there's many fields, there's uncountably many varieties, uncountably many polarizations we can choose, uncountably many Barashkin transformations, but still the possible degree sequences that appear are only countably many. And just
I mean, you also vary the ground field, right?
Ground field, yeah, can vary. But it's okay. I will give the idea of the proof, which is mostly like a trick. So if you have a degree sequence, it's defined by a tuple. So it depends on the ground field k, on the projective variety x over k, on the divisor h, and on the Barashkin transformation f. So k and field x smooth projective over k, h and divisor. This talk, like for me, smooth is always geometrically smooth. I come to reasons. So, but okay, now we see all these x, the variety, the amplifier, and plus and f, they are defined by only a finite number of coefficients in k. So, x, h, and f are. Coefficients in K. So let's call this set S. It follows that X, H, and F are already defined over the field. K prime, which is just the finitely generated field extension by the elements in S, where K0 is the prime field, K0 is Q or FP, depending on the characteristic. And then, actually, what one can observe if you look at how the degree is defined, so this is by these intersection numbers, and they are invariant under base change, so the intersection numbers are the same for this two tuples. So if you look at k prime, x prime, h prime, k prime x, k prime h, k prime, and f over k prime. So this tuple defines exactly the same degree sequence as our original tuple. And now we see that, there are only. I mean, here there's only countably many prime fields, and for each of them there are only countably many finitely generated field extensions. So we only have countably many such base fields. And then over each of these countably many base fields, they are countable themselves, so there's only countably many choices for all of these. So there's only countably many such tuples that we can choose.
the name, which is the punch, which is the script. I am the generator.
I think it might fall just from subjectivity, because on each step you have finally many choices by the bound which is provided by subjectivity. So you have countably many sequences just because on each step, when you add the next number, it's from finitely many choices.
Okay, we must have to,
you can consider just sequences of zeros and ones.
So there's a so it's a silly proof because it doesn't add anything to geometrical understanding or dynamical understanding. But it gives some hope that these could be special sequences and it might be worth studying them more. But maybe it's also exactly the same technique for the exercise. You can use this technique to show that there are only countably many finitely generated groups of birational transformations. Can be done exactly by the same technique because they are many finite generated. Because to define a finitely generated group, you only need finitely many elements of the field, and then you run the same argument again. And yeah, you just recall that there are uncountably many finitely generated groups. So this also gives some hope that groups of birational transformations might be very special groups. Okay, that's just some motivation or some outlook that it might be a good idea to study these questions in higher dimensions. But let's go to dimension 2, because here here we have a nice hyperbolic space and many things are known. It's okay, again, let's look at the Cremona transformations and so we want to see what kind of degree growth can we have in the other two. So here's the best to start with some examples. So for example, if we take the very easy transformation f that's given by x plus y square y, so this element has degree 2. Now if we iterate this transformation, then we see each time there's one y square more added. So this doesn't change the degree, so the degree of f to the n equals 2 for all n bigger than 1, bigger than 1, because if it's 0, so the degree is added. Now we see if we slightly change the transformation, so if we look at f y x plus y square, so-called Cremona transformation. So here we see now if we iterate this transformation, it's this term that dominates. So each time you have y square, the next time y to the 4, so really it grows exponential. So the degree of f iterated n times is 2 to the power n. Okay. And then there's yet another example. For example, look at the transformation that's given by x times y. We see if we iterate this transformation, each time there's we multiply with an x more, the second factor, so the degree increases one, so the degree of f iterated n times equals n plus 1. Okay, so we see here we have bounded. Here growth is exponential, and here the growth is polynomial or linear. Okay, and then one can also find some transformations with the polynomial growth. So I will not write down the explicit formula. Longer. But then actually it turned out that these are all the possibilities that can occur. So there's a big theorem which we will use very often in
quadratic
growth, yeah. But this I don't want to write down an example. Yeah, I will write in the theorem. So the big step, I would say, the first big step to Tursis theorem was achieved by Gitzatullin. Then, after Diller and Favre in the paper, generalized it, and then the last part, which I will decide, is self-contact. So, if we have, let's say, an algebraically closed field, and F transformation over ERP2, okay. Then one of the following is true. So the first possibility is that the degree of Fn is bounded. And then we need some space because I want to write them more often. Then the second possibility is that the degree of Fn grows asymptotically like c to the n for some constant c. Then we have a third possibility, B, because it's similar to this one, is that the degree of Fn grows asymptotically quadratically. And then we have the third possibility is that the degree of Fn grows asymptotically exponentially. And here it's the amplitude degree. Okay, very nice. So this is this is like some description. You see there's only very specific growths that are possible. So okay, if optimistic people, they would maybe hope that in bigger dimensions, in higher dimensions, you always have the alternative bounded, polynomial, or exponential. And it hasn't been disproved so far. This maybe optimistic conjecture, but yet. It's also nothing, basically nothing is known in dimension 3. But here the nice thing is that it doesn't just have a description of the degree growth, but it also tells us some geometric properties of the corresponding element. So in this case, this is equivalent to either f being of finite order, of course then degree is bounded, or F is conjugated to an automorphism of P2. So these are the only possibilities. In this case, it implies that
What is your final score?
F is a finite number in the Cremona group. Yeah, right, yeah, if you iterate it, then of course the degree is very good. As an element. So this implies that F preserves a rational vibration. This, if the degree growth is quadratic, this implies that F preserves analytic vibration. Or if the degree, if the characteristic is more free, it can also be quasi analytic.
Rational vibration
is
the fibre
direction
called
the
base.
The fibre. It preserves the fibres, yeah.
Anyway. So it should be rational anyway.
The fibers are rational, but yes, the base. And you're saying like the fibers are genus 1 curves. Analytic vibration. And here, I'm sure that F preserves no vibration. This. Then you should note that this is somehow the generic case. So if you like take random polynomials as a Cremona transformations, then there will be no simplification happening if you iterate it. So most of them are in this case.
This is lambda of f.
Lambda of f is the dynamic degree of f. So it's the limit of I can write it again.
Can you say anything about the end of that?
If I have time I will say something. So this is the limit of and so this in your cases of course the dynamical degree is 1. So maybe you already said positive. Okay, but now we want to kind of link this to our hyperbolic space, and that's actually where it really gets nice.
It's about lambda of f again. It could be any real number or algebraic number. Or
so in dimension 2, it's always a Salem or a Pisa number, so an algebraic integer.
Algebraic integer.
Yeah. But in higher dimensions, that's not
this deep.
It's a subset of Pisa or Salem numbers. The thing is, with the Salem numbers, there's this conjecture we don't know whether they have a gap between 1 and the Lehmann number. Whereas here, in this case, we know there's a gap. So these have the gap properties.
So special Salem.
Special Salem numbers. Yeah.
And we can describe them.
I think no. We can show that certain things are okay, but it's in general. I'm actually not sure if you could name a Salem number that cannot be realized. It's an open conjecture for Salem numbers.
But you know that there is a gap for the 90 degrees.
Yeah.
You just don't know if there are Salem numbers in this gap.
We know there's a gap for dynamic degrees, and there's a conjecture that
if there is a single Salem number in this particular gap, then you know.
If there is a Salem number in the gap, then yeah. But the conjecture is open, so.
Is it possible to say what it is?
Okay. Sure, let me talk about it now. So, so a Pisson number is a real algebraic integer. let's say beta alpha bigger than 1, such that all gamma conjugates of alpha have modulus strictly smaller than 1. So for example, if you take a quadratic, if you take a real quadratic integer, it's automatically a Fizeau number. And then a solid number
modulus means under objects of data. What do you mean by modulus?
By
non under complex embedding. Embedding can be complex numbers. Modulus.
Ah, yeah, indeed. Yeah.
So it's a square root of 2 is greater than 1.
Smaller one. Then, but the real algebra, the Fizeau number is larger than 1.
So 2 plus 1, for example, yes?
2 is not.
So one of them is a. One of them, like, real algebraic quadratic integers of modulus bigger than 1.
I mean, all other conjugates except for alpha itself, that's what I
mean.
Should be modulus greater than 1.
Of course.
Yeah, except this one, yeah. Yeah. I mean. And solid number, it's a real algebraic integer, beta bigger 1, such that, first of all, we want that 1 divided by beta is.
Sorry, I assume you get a point. What about square root of 2?
Square root of 2 is a Fizeau number.
Because the other guy is minus
1. Minus square root of 2
is less than 1. No. What's modulus? Still modulus.
Ah.
So modulus is the.
No, no, sorry. No, it's wrong. No. It's wrong. No. It is. It's not.
Square root of 2.
Square root is not. It's
plus
1. Yes, square root. Yes. Sorry. Yeah. Okay, so a solid number is a real algebraic integer such as 1 or b delta is a Galois conjugate of beta, and all other conjugates have modulus 1. So these are the more. Somehow it's a kind of more special thing. Yeah, the thing about quadratic integers that I said is. So here we ask that the inverse is a Galois conjugate of beta. But then.
Because it's not of modulus 1, because.
But maybe you have to add also.
And we can maybe ask that there's at least one.
Quadratic integers, right?
That's right here.
Or degree is not necessarily a sum or a Fizeau number.
Yes. I will. And there exists at least. There's at least one conjugate. Modulus 1. So that they are destroyed. And yes. Let's take this as a definition. So quadratic numbers are never solid numbers. They can be Fizeau numbers or they cannot be Fizeau numbers. And now the theorem by Bieler, Pfaffer, and Long and Pantin was that The dynamical degrees are always, I think here actually for all surfaces. Then the dynamical degree of F is a piece of orthogonal number. And they show that there's two possibilities here. Either F is conjugate to some automorphism of some surface, and in this case it is always a sign number or a quadratic integer.
Not always a sign number, it can also be quadratic, right?
Yeah, but it can only be quadratic integers that are Pisa numbers.
Yeah, but the quadratic integer. Okay,
And for example, if you take the eigenvalues of a matrix. So, okay, if lambda f is a sign number, then F is conjugate to an automorphism. And if F is conjugate to an automorphism, then lambda of F is a sign number or a quadratic integer. Okay, and then they show that it has the gap property. And they have also special part of theorem is that lambda of f is lambda of f is not contained between 0 and this Lehmann number. It's a given algebraic integer that's known to be a solid number, but it's an open question whether there are smaller solid numbers in this one. But for the direction, for the dynamical degrees, this is known. Okay, does this answer the questions? So,
what is the Lehmann number?
So this is the root of x to the 10 plus x to the 9 plus minus, oh, I think x to the 7. Yeah, it's a polynomial. And that's the root of this, which is going to be a solid number.
Positive.
Solid number, yeah. Solid numbers are always larger than one.
And then it's solid? Lehmann number is solid?
Yeah, yeah.
So if lambda of f is Pisa number, then f is not
conjugated. If it's a non-quadratic Pisa number. And then for quadratic Pisa numbers, it's actually either is possible.
It's possible you run 1 instead of 0, right?
1, yes.
So what's the simplest Pisa number? Which are quadratic irrational.
You have to think of it. Yeah, because there's for Pisa numbers actually it's known that they are that they cannot be arbitrarily small, it's just a plastic number which has. Okay, but let's go back maybe to hyperbolic space, so we don't use all the time. I mean, it's a nice subject.
is just P2, much more restrictive than a more arbitrary surface.
No, I don't think so. P2 is really richest. I'm not sure if there's examples known of numbers that can appear as dynamical degrees of non-rational surfaces that can appear as in P2 design. I'm not sure. I think not.
So is there a F which has Poisson number which is not quadratic or rational? Is it known explicitly? Or?
I think so, yeah.
And it's not conjugate over any algebra field?
Yes.
So this is this in this paper?
In this Dinner and Fabre, they looked at the questions way earlier, and they showed that it's always a solid one piece of number.
Yes.
But then actually in Grand Compound they showed the and this gap property. Okay, so now we actually go back to continue the construction from yesterday. So yesterday we saw that that the Cremona group acts on this infinite dimensional hyperbolic space by isometries. This infinite-dimensional hyperbolic space, but this this hyperboloid in this Hilbert space. So it was given by all the vectors that have self-intersection one within this Hilbert space, and that lie the upper hyperboloid. Then one more thing. So this is infinity. Then we can also note we can define the boundary of this space as we do in the plane, and in this case it would be for us the boundary is always the lines of the cone of vectors with a self-intersection zero. They are the boundary, they control that's the boundary in every nice hyperbolic sense. So the cone of boundary and so on. Okay, so now let's just recall some facts about isometries of hyperbolic space. So there are three types of isometries. So to describe them, we assume alpha to be any isometry, H infinity, and we define the length L alpha, the length alpha, to be the minimum. Is that the length of alpha equals zero, and that the infimum is actually attained. So this means that alpha has a fixed point in the hyperbolic space. Here, there's some, well, it can have many fixed points, there are fixed points, and it turns the points around these 6 points.
And of course, then the second possibility is that this L alpha is zero, but it's not a tank, so it has no fixed point. So this implies that alpha has no fixed points, no fixed point in H infinity, but exactly one fixed point at the boundary. So that's hyperbolic geometry. In the two-dimensional case, but also in some ways here, like it's basically fixes one point at the boundary, so here the boundary, and then the isometry is somehow along these Horow cycles. And the third possibility is that the length of alpha is strictly positive, and in this case, alpha is always obtained. And moreover, we have that, that the set of all the points x in the hyperbolic space such that the distance between x and alpha x equals alpha is a geodesic line. This set is a geodesic line, and this we call the axis of F, and then F acts by translation along this axis. So it's translation, but of course there's many directions, so it twists it around. And so that, but it's translation only. Basically, in this case, we have your geodesic line, the axis, and the translation is given by the isometry is given by shift. In this case, alpha fixes exactly 2 points. 2 points.
This alpha is always given by a linear operator, I mentioned. Is it always given by a linear operator in the space?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think so. I'm pretty sure it's
almost probably a classification.
Yeah. I think general from here the classification. So the so in this case we are selected that the translation is in this direction, then one can show that this, if you look at the action on the boundary of the transformation, then this fixed point is attractive and this one is repulsive. That's a response to the eigen.
This shape does it all, right?
Yes.
Yes, it's
all. Nice. So this is called, so isometries of this type are called elliptic. Isometries of this type are called parabolic. And isometries of this type are called, like so long.
And in this picture you say there is 2 angles, right?
Yeah.
Why not more to have H
infinity? Yeah, but can we show that if it preserves the hyperboloid, it has only 2.
Okay, so this now we call Trevola conformation, elliptic, parabolic, or oxochromic if the induced isometry on the hyperbolic space is elliptic, parabolic, or oxochromic. And the beautiful thing, so to complete this theorem, is that this first case corresponds to F being the isometry in this case being elliptic. The second case corresponds to the case for 2A and 2B that the isometry on the hyperbolic space induced isometry is parabolic, and this last case corresponds to the situation where the induced isometry is loxochromic. That's actually this what makes this action on this hyperboloid so interesting. Is not only do we know that it acts on a hyperboloid, but we have a translation of what does it mean in terms of geometry and dynamics of the Cremona transformation, and what we can translate this to what does it do on the hyperboloid. And we will see in the next lectures how this can be used to deduce properties about group structure of BOP2.